So I'd like to present my book, I Am an Island. It's written as a non-fiction memoir, and it's been discussed as a book that breaks open the genre. But it starts off traditionally. So I'm in London, and I'm living a very different life in the heart of Notting Hill Gate. And I'm in my 30s, and I'm on a ladder that's going quite upright and fast with a career in media and photography. I was at the BBC and in publishing and advertising. And suddenly, in that way that sometimes happens, life just stops me in my tracks and I'm in a big car smash, and it forces me to really reevaluate my life. So in my recovery, I changed my job, I changed my location to a different part of town, and I also changed my status as being alone, and I marry. And everything's looking really good, and I'm longing for family, hoping that the accident isn't going to stop those dreams. And something happens from which we can only step forwards and make a more radical change to leave London and go north. The book is divided into three acts. So we have Act One, and Act Two, and Act Three, and each part charts a very distinct part of that journey. We jump forwards and we land on this island, and it's a very bleak day in March, and the weather's wild, and perhaps the ferry won't cross, and the squalls are high. We see a piece of ground that's 22 acres. It has a derelict croft on, and even though it looks total desolation, we both look at each other and something ignites, and we really envisage the potential of this place and a wilder life that we've not seen before. And the book charts that integration and the challenges and joys and rewards and struggles that we each solely and individually and together face. And suddenly coming forwards, my life changes again, and I'm back on my own, and that life has not quite worked out as it might have done. And this is where the book changes from the genre in which it's housed, and it really is about the real life journey, one that isn't euthanized. So I'd like to describe the island that I live on. It's in a very dramatic part of the Scottish west coast. It sits offshore on its own, surrounded by an extraordinary panoramic of mountains. So these are the great peaks of Scotland, the ones that are in all of the books and that many people long to discover. These are the Big Munros, and that view I wake up to every single day. So I've just left snowy peaks and trees that are just coming into bloom and all of the wild flowers. It also has a particular rock that is unique to that area, and so the island itself is an anomaly. So it's largely very fertile, rich, alkaline farming community. Traditions go back, way back, way back, way back, and that was one of the challenges that I faced, not just when I arrived there with my husband to farm, something that we'd never done before. So taking on the business of keeping sheep, keeping cows. I also took on a broodmare that was wild and did all of that backing myself instinctively. I trained my sheepdog and ended up lambing and calving, and found that these skills we all hold inside us, these are they're almost like the unwritten history inside each of us, and we discover them as they animate through the telling of their own story, through the use of our hands and our bodies. And I discovered that I had a real talent for this, and that really enabled me to, when the time came, to start to take ownership, albeit at the time, at the start of Act Two, I'm suddenly on my own and I have two broken hands and working out how on earth am I going to run and manage the life that I've chosen to inhabit and which now is almost at risk of overwhelming me. And we need to find a different balance and a different dialogue so that we can each sustain each other. And Act two is about that journey into a deeper immersion and coming out the other side with really working in sync and harmony with the landscape, both internal and external, to create that beautiful integrated life that I always sought.